إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدًا عبد الله تعالى ورسوله، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال تعالى أيضا: قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله، إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا، إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. صدق الله العظيم. As always, we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower his choicest of blessings upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, to proceed, first and foremost, I enjoin upon myself and then all of y'all who have come here to adopt a life of taqwa. For it is only through a life of taqwa can a believer attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, taqwa is the ultimate goal behind why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us and created every single creation in this universe. Allah the Almighty says in the Noble Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have not created mankind or jinkind for any other purpose other than ibadah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us, mankind and jinkind, for no other purpose other than to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another place, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. O mankind, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. O mankind, worship your Lord who created you, who created all of y'all, and created the ones before y'all, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّكُونَ, so that you will become people of taqwa. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, every single thing around us, we see around us, including ourselves, has been created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His worship. Allah the Almighty created this universe, the planets in it, the sun, the moon, the mountains, the skies, the heavens, us, the animals, the plants, the trees, every single thing for the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is the goal behind the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The ultimate goal behind the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so that we become people of taqwa. This is the ultimate goal. To become people of taqwa. To adopt a life of taqwa. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, O slaves of Allah, we live in a time where the Muslim Ummah at large is being battered from all corners. Whether we look at it internationally or locally, the enemies of Islam are advancing to try to extinguish Islam and to try and destroy the followers of Islam. But there is something that we need to put right in our hearts. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, victory has been sealed for the Muslims and Islam. Allah the Almighty says in the Noble Quran, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَأَغْلِبَنَّ أَنَا وَرُسُلِي إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed that He and His messengers will overpower every single thing. Allahu Akbar. Victory has been decreed for us. There may be external forces outside trying to extinguish the flame of Islam, trying to extinguish the light of Islam, but they will never ever succeed. And it is upon us to be brave, to be courageous, for we are lions who roar aloud, and we aren't mice that scatter around. We Muslimun are not mice that squeak and scatter around, but rather we are lions. Islam has left behind a golden legacy that we are not supposed to forget. We have the likes of Umar radiallahu anhu, Ali radiallahu anhu, Uthman ibn Affan, Khalid ibn al-Walid, Tariq ibn Ziyad, Salahuddin al-Ayyubi, Al-Qa'qa ibn Amr al-Tamimi, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in. These are the likes, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. So don't ever, ever forget the legacy that Islam has left for us, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. So based on this, I thought of titling my khutbah as Two Solutions in Regard to Our Troubled Times. And I wish to focus on these two solutions. There are many solutions, but Islam gives us two primary solutions. If we bring that, these two solutions in our lives, we are bound to attain peace, and likewise, we are bound to be successful in this world as well as the hereafter. Solution number one is to adopt a life of taqwa. Solution number two is to flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To flee to our powerful maker. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, something special about the fear of Allah is that in general, when you fear someone or when you fear something, in general you run away from that thing or from that person. When you fear someone, when you fear something, you generally distance yourself. You run away from that thing. But with the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the special thing about the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that the more we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more closer we run towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. The more we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more we flee towards Him, the more we run towards Him. May Allah the Almighty fill our hearts with His fear. So what is taqwa? I avoided translating it in the beginning because I was to sort out the definition of taqwa as we go in the khutbah. What is taqwa? Some people have translated it as the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and some people have translated it as the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I would say the best explanation, or the most beautiful explanation in regard to the term taqwa, is the explanation of Al-Imam Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani rahimahullah. He says in regard to taqwa that taqwa is an Arabic term which stems from the root waqayaqi wiqaya, which means to put up a barrier, to put up a protection, or to put up something to prevent you from something, to put up a barrier to protect you from something that may harm you. So he says taqwa is that you putting up a barrier, you putting up a protection from the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ghadab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the azab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by doing what? By acting upon all of the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and staying away from all that which Allah the Almighty has prohibited us from. This is what taqwa is. A beautiful explanation indeed. Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah. Let's look at what our Salafun al-Salih have said about taqwa. A man once goes to Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu and asks Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, Ya Abu Huraira, define taqwa for me. Can you define taqwa for me? Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu asks that man, have you ever walked down a thorny path? Have you ever walked down a thorny path? The man replies, yes, I have. Why? Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu asks him then again, so what did you do whilst you were walking down the thorny path? The man replied, I gathered my clothes together and I took precaution. I moved away from the thorns. I took precaution that I did not snag my clothes against the thorns. I took extreme precaution, moved away from the thorns and traversed down that path carefully. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu says, then that is exactly what taqwa is. The path is this temporary life that we are traversing upon. Our destination is al-akhirah. We are not going to remain forever on that path. And the thorns are the muharramat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These thorns are out there to snag us, to trap us. So it is upon us to take precaution to move away from the thorns so that we do not become injured or hurt due to those thorns and we move down the path towards our destination, which is al-akhirah. A famous Arab poet, his name was Ibn al-Mu'taz. He, based on this statement or this narration, he brought about a beautiful piece of poetry. He says, خلي الذنوب صغيرها وكبيرها خلي الذنوب صغيرها وكبيرها واصنع كماش فوق أرض الشوك يحذر ما يرى يحذر ما يرى ولا تحقرن صغيرا إن الجبال من الحصى. الله أكبر. Ibn al-Mu'taz, the Arab poet, he says, leave sins in its totality. Leave all of the sins, whether the sin be a minor sin or a major sin, leave all of the sins. Leave, stay away from the prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And be like a person walking down a thorny path. Be like a person walking down a thorny path. يَحْذَرُ مَا يَرَى. Taking precaution at every angle. For wherever he looks at, he sees thorns. He sees thorns. So he's taking extreme precaution and walking carefully. وَلَا تَحْقِرَنَّ صَغِيرًا. And do not ever look down upon any deed, whether it be good or whether it be evil. That is the explanation of that statement. وَلَا تَحْقِرَنَّ صَغِيرًا. Do not look down upon any deed, whether the deed be good or whether the deed be evil. However minor or however insignificant the deed may be, do not look down upon it, whether it be good or evil. For indeed, mountains are made of tiny pebbles. Mountains are made of tiny pebbles. So don't think insignificant of your good deeds, of your tiny good deeds. Perhaps that piece of date you gave out sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may be or may become the cause for your salvation from the blazing inferno of Jahannam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the fire of Jahannam. Likewise, that tiny sin, that tiny evil deed that you thought insignificant, that tiny glance you stole at that beautiful girl, or that tiny, you thought it to be tiny, going through a pornographic site or watching obscene material. You might have thought it a tiny sin, because gradually what sins or what shaitan does is that he makes sins become insignificant to us, so much to the extent that we think of it like a fly on our shoulders. But in reality, each sin adds up and becomes a mountain of sins. Allahu Akbar. May Allah save us all. On the day of Qiyamah, when we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when every single action of ours will be put up on display over there, we will be amazed. We will be wondering, how come all of this has come there? How come mountains of sins are up on that screen? Allahu Akbar. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that is because we thought insignificant of our evil deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. May Allah the Almighty save us all. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is upon us to bring in taqwa, to adopt the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala coupled with the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the more we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more we will bring in His consciousness. Fear is an attribute which is not with a person 24/7. But if you say you're conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is something which would be with you 24/7, wherever you may be. Whether you be amongst the public or whether you be all alone by yourself, you are conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah the Most High, who gave over 5 billion, 6 billion, 7 billion human beings the sight to see with so much of clarity, why do we think that Allah the Most Powerful is blind? Do you think that He is blind to our actions? Do you think that if you are alone, or perhaps if you are in a foreign country where no one knows you, that you can commit a sin and get away with it? Allah the Almighty is watching every single deed of ours. Everything is being recorded in a perfect book, and all of that will be put up on display. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the route to bringing in taqwa is to flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is at-tawbah. See, today many of us, we have the misconception about tawbah, that tawbah is something reserved for sinners alone, or that tawbah is something reserved for the month of Ramadan, or that tawbah is something which a person has to turn to only when he commits a sin. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we have got it wrong. Because tawbah is something so important that every slave of Allah needs to make tawbah part and parcel of his day-to-day life. Every single day we need to practice upon tawbah, which is basically turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tawbah is to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to flee to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now let's look at what is tawbah. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says, أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْرِفُونَ قَدْرَ التَّوْبَةِ وَلَا حَقِيقَتَهَا. Many people do not know the reality of tawbah nor its value. Many people do not know what is tawbah exactly, or what is the reality of tawbah, the value of tawbah. فَضْلًا عَنِ الْقِيَامِ بِهَا عِلْمًا وَعَمَلًا وَحَالًا. Leave alone acting upon tawbah. Many people do not know the value of tawbah, the reality of tawbah, or what tawbah is all about. Leave alone acting upon tawbah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in reality, tawbah is the whole of Islam. All of Islam is within the term or the concept of tawbah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if you look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, غفر الله ما تقدم من ذنبه وما تأخر. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven his past sins and even if there be any future sins. All of that has been forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Has any one of us got that guarantee from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? But even though our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had that guarantee that Allah the Almighty has wiped his slate clean, he still used to make tawbah or turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance, seeking his forgiveness in one narration more than 70 times per day. Per day. And in another narration almost 100 times if I'm not mistaken. Allahu Akbar. Where are we, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? Like I asked in the beginning, have any one of us got a guarantee from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that all of our sins are forgiven? We commit sins perpetually, on a daily basis, on an hourly basis. We can't walk out on the streets, we are committing sins. We open our mouths, we are committing sins. We are sinners. So how much do you think we need to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How much do you think we need to practice at tawbah? And this is why Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says that many of us do not know the value of tawbah, leave alone acting upon. So the term tawbah is an Arabic term which literally means ar-ruju', turning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or turning back. For the word tawbah, there are other meanings which come, there are other words that come upon the same meaning, such as taba, thaba, aba, anaba. All of these words stand for the same meaning, that is to turn back. And in when you talk about tawbah, it is to turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To turn to Allah the Almighty, seeking in repentance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran,
وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. O you believers, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ,
so that you will become successful in this world as well as the hereafter. Look at the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing us. Allah did not say, O sinners, turn to Allah in tawbah. Allah did not say, O the ones who have oppressed yourself, or the ones who have transgressed the limits of Allah, turn to Allah. Nay, Allah the Almighty addresses us as the believers, not even as Muslimun. Mu'minun, ayyuhal mu'minun, the ones who have brought in iman. O believers, turn to Allah the Almighty in tawbah. So you might think, what is the reason or why do believers need to turn to Allah in tawbah? And that is why I said in the beginning that tawbah has to become part and parcel of all of our day-to-day lives. It's not only reserved for the sinners, it's not only reserved for the month of Ramadan. No! All of us need to bring in tawbah if we wish to be successful in this world as well as the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتُبْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. And as for the one who does not make tawbah, as for the one who does not turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ, they are the ones who have transgressed the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the oppressors. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. And in regard to sins, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, no sin is great in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the minute a slave of his turns to him in sincere tawbah. In sincere tawbah, no sin, not even shirk, as long as he makes tawbah before he passes away from this world. If a man wearing the robe of shirk stands upon the doorstep of tawheed and he removes the robes of shirk, turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in sincere tawbah,
Allah the Almighty is waiting to accept the tawbah of that slave. Allahu Akbar. This is how merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. The ayah I recited at the beginning of the khutbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ibadiyya alladhina asrafu. For my slaves, O my slaves, alladhina asrafu ala anfusihim, the ones who have oppressed themselves, la taqnatu min rahmatillah. Do not ever despair in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look at how our beloved Maker is addressing us. Once again, he did not address us as, oh sinners, the ones who have oppressed themselves, or oh oppressors. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses us, oh my slaves. Allahu Akbar. That itself, the form of addressing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fills our hearts with hope. Fills our hearts with hope that Allah the Almighty will accept our tawbah if we turn to Him sincerely. Let me mention a beautiful narration. This narration is recorded in Tirmidhi on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, who says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, and this is a hadith Qudsi. I think all of you all know what a hadith Qudsi is. A hadith Qudsi is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reported through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it is not considered as Quran, it is considered from the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah the Almighty is addressing all of us. Allah the Almighty is addressing all of us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and before I go on, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this narration should fill our hearts with hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In reality, this narration must make us tear when we think of how loving our Maker is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses us, Yabna Adam, O son of Adam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to each and every one of us. Allah the Almighty is addressing each and every one of us. Ya bana Adam, innaka ma da'awtani wa rajawtani ghafartu laka ala ma kana fika wa la ubali. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. O son of Adam, as long as you invocate unto me, as long as you supplicate unto me, and as long as you have hope in me, غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ فِيكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي. I will forgive all of your sins. غَفَرْتُ لَكَ. I'll forgive you, and I will not even care about your sins. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say, يَبْنَ آدَم. يَبْنَ آدَم. O son of Adam. Allah is addressing each and every one of us. Listen attentively. لَوْ بَلَغَتْ ذُنُوبُكَ عَنَانَ السَّمَاءِ ثُمَّ اسْتَغْفَرْتَنِي غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ فِيكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي. Even if your sins were to tower and reach the skies, Allahu Akbar. O son of Adam, even if your sins were to tower and reach the heavens, and then you turn to me seeking forgiveness from me, غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ فِيكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي. I will forgive you, and I will not care about those sins. Allahu Akbar. Look at how merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. The hadith does not end there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on. يَبْنَ آدَم. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَبْنَ آدَم, O son of Adam, إنك لو أتيتني بقراب الأرض خطايا إنك لو أتيتني بقراب الأرض خطايا ثم لقيتني لا تشرك بي شيئا لأتيتك بقرابها مغفرة. الله أكبر. أو son of Adam, even if you were to come to me with this whole world, in other words, with sins equivalent to this whole planet, even if you were to come to me with sins amounting or equivalent to this whole planet, ثُمَّ لَقِيتَنِي لَا تُشْرِكُ بِي شَيْئًا. But you meet me in a state that you are upon tawheed. The explanation of the narration, that you are upon tawheed, that you are not associating partners unto me, I will come to you with a forgiveness equivalent to your sins. Allahu Akbar. I will come to you with a forgiveness equivalent to this whole planet. This is how merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. But sadly, it is us. We, the ones who have oppressed ourselves, we have wronged ourselves, and we have also lost hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A more bigger sin than the sins we commit is that we have lost hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That alone, that itself needs a separate tawbah. That we have lost hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many of us think, oh, I am too big a sinner. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would never forgive my sins. Allah the Almighty is waiting for us to turn to Him, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And there is a deadline in regard to tawbah. There is a deadline. You have to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before Malakul Maut comes and stands in front of you. Before Malakul Maut comes and stands in front of you. None of us seated here, nor myself, do we have the guarantee that we would last even to go and reach our homes. We may have an hour remaining. We may have 2 hours remaining. We may have 3 hours. We may have a decade. Or we may have many, many years to live. But none of us, we don't know how long we have remaining. What if by the time, a hypothetical question, what if by the time we reach our homes, Malakul Maut is standing waiting for us at the doorstep of our homes? Are we ready to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If each and every one of us were to touch our hearts, we would know the sins that we have committed, the sins that we are currently in, and the sins that we are planning to commit, whilst we don't even know how long we are going to live on the face of this earth. None of us can say that Malakul Maut will come on this date and on that day to meet me. No! Malakul Maut may come at any time. There is an authentic narration. Malakul Maut goes to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam in the guise of a human being. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, thinking that it was an intruder who broke into his house, he gave Malakul Maut one blow. Malakul Maut, basically that blow blackened the eye of Malakul Maut because he came in the guise of a human being. Malakul Maut goes straight up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and informs Allah the Almighty that, Ya Allah, your slave is not ready to meet you. The narration goes along the lines of these words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, O Malakul Maut, go and give my prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam this option. Tell him to place his hand on the back of a bull. To place his hand on the back of a bull. And for every strand of hair that touches his palm, he will get an extension of a year. So if 100 strands were to strike his palm, he would get an extension of 100 years, of a century. Malakul Maut comes down and informs Musa alayhi salatu wasalam as to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had informed him. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam then asked Malakul Maut, okay, if I were to touch the back of a bull and say I get 100 years, what after that? What after the 100 years? Or what after the 200 years? Or what after the 1,000 years? What will happen? Malakul Maut very coolly replies, inevitably I will come again. Inevitably I will come again to take your soul. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam then says, it is better for you to take my soul right now. What is the point? This life is anyway going to end. It is a transitory stage, like I said in the beginning. None of us are here permanently. Our permanent abode is al-akhirah. We need to be securing investments that will bless, that will give us a good life in al-akhirah. There is no point in building mansions and buying cars and all other things in this world, even though it is not haram, but we need to be asking ourselves, what have we done to secure a good life in al-akhirah? For if we were to live a life of hardship in this world, but if we are to secure a good life in akhirah, that is victory and that is success. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is upon us to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in sincere tawbah before Malakul Maut comes and stands in front of us. For the minute Malakul Maut comes and stands in front of us, and when our soul is leaving our bodies, then if we were to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the tawbah will not be accepted. The tawbah at the throes of death, when you're in Saqarat, when your soul is about to leave, your tawbah will not be accepted. And finally, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, you need to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in sincere tawbah before the sun rises from the west. Currently, the door of tawbah is wide open. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is waiting to accept our tawbah. But when the sun rises from the west, and that is something which is bound to occur very soon, because signs are taking place. The signs of Qiyamah, the minor signs, most of them have gone by. All that is remaining are another few minor signs and then the list of major signs. And from them, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is the sun rising from the west. It could even take place in another day or two. Allahu alam, Allah knows best. But if the sun rises from the west, the door of Tawbah will be slammed shut. And then even after witnessing that great sign, if we were to turn to Allah the Almighty and cry tears of blood, not tears of the salty liquid, but rather tears of blood, the door of Tawbah will not be opened again for anyone. And then our Tawbah will not be accepted. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the two solutions that I mentioned, we are living in troubled times and it is upon us to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as soon as possible and to adopt a life of taqwa. For the victory is coming for the Muslimun. And if we want to be part of that victory, it is upon us to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in tawbah and to adopt a life of taqwa. For even in that process, even if death were to overtake us, we are guaranteed, because we know it is victory and success in the akhirah. For us Muslimun, death is either Jannah or Shahada, martyrdom. These are the two things that we must look forward to. For our life on this world is temporary and we do not fear death. Death is nothing to us. We are ready to even face or go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even the next minute if we apply these two solutions, if we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in sincere tawbah, and if we fear and are conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we would not fear to look death in its eye. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill all of our hearts with taqwa. And may Allah the Almighty help us to turn to Him in sincere tawbah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May He accept all of our good deeds. And may He the Almighty unite